Hello, the time now is 7:30. Welcome if you've just joined us. You're watching the BBC's Breakfast News. Sarah has a summary of this morning's main stories.
The pop star Freddie Mercury died last night in London. The lead singer with Queen, aged 45, had announced on Saturday he was suffering from AIDS. There'd been speculation about Freddie Mercury's health for months. In contrast with his flamboyant stage presence, he'd shunned publicity in his private life and had become a virtual recluse in recent years.
That summary, after months of speculation, the rock star Freddie Mercury confirmed at the weekend that he had AIDS and he died last night at the age of 45. Our arts correspondent Andrew Burrows reports now on the career of Queen's lead singer, who for two decades was one of Britain's greatest rock stars.
Freddie Mercury's flamboyant stage presence was the driving force behind one of Britain's most enduring rock acts. The band, which thrilled the Live Aid audience, first reached number one by adding operatic elements and a new sophistication in video style to 70s glam rock.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah, no, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let me go!
We'll not let you go.
Let me go!
We'll not let you go.
Freddie was to return to opera in later ventures away from Queen.
I want all the world to see. Lyrical sensation, my guiding inspiration. Now my dream is slowly coming true.
Freddie Mercury was openly bisexual. He enjoyed the rock star lifestyle to the full. He was born in Zanzibar of Persian descent and spent most of his childhood in India before going to art school in London. He was generous with his wealth and famous for his wild parties, though he played down the glamorous side.
To me, I just, you know, just like a housewife, to be honest. I just go on there, go on there and do my job and then come home.
Crazy little thing I love.
Towards the end, the dynamic performer became a recluse. Deterioration in his health only glimpsed in occasional photographs. He'll be remembered not just for his flamboyance, but for his often poignant songs.
There's a guy up in the sky, looking down. What must we do? What we've done to the world that we
Freddie Mercury, who died last night.
Rock star Freddie Mercury dies of AIDS. Man shot in Belfast after fatal prison bomb. Ian Richter celebrates his release with family. And the search resumes for missing fishermen. Good morning, the news from TVAM on Monday, the 25th of November. The rock star Freddie Mercury has died of AIDS. The 45-year-old lead singer of Queen died at his home in London. His death was the result of bronchopneumonia brought on by AIDS and came only a day after he revealed he was suffering from the disease. Sarah McCoy reports.
At midnight, it was announced that Freddie Mercury had died peacefully at his London home. Friends leaving the house, including rock impresario Dave Clark, said they were very saddened by his death. Fans also paid their own tributes.
I bought some flowers and I left a card in there saying to Freddie, the greatest rock star that ever lived.
For the last year, the rock star has been a virtual recluse amid widespread speculation that he had AIDS. Then, just a day before his death, he admitted having the disease, saying the time had come for his friends and fans around the world to know the truth. As the lead singer in Queen, Freddie Mercury will be most remembered for the group's phenomenal hit, Bohemian Rhapsody, which launched the idea of promotional videos. Born Fred Bulzara in Zanzibar in 1946, he teamed up with Roger Taylor, Brian May and John Deacon to form the group. Over the next 10 years, they established themselves as a major international rock act, with Freddie Mercury their flamboyant vocalist.
He could write, he could sing in a very strong voice, and he gave us a kind of flamboyance, as I've said before, which very few artists are willing to even attempt. He knew stagecraft, he used it, and he gave 100% all the time.
A private cremation is planned for later this week. Meanwhile, fans from across the country are expected to come here to Freddie Mercury's home to pay their tributes to a man regarded as one of the best in the business. Sarah McCoy, TVAM News in central London.
Last night, the day after he announced that he had AIDS. He was 45 and had been lead singer with the group Queen for 20 years. He'll be cremated at a private ceremony later this week, Ian Findlay reports.
Despite his flamboyant, often outrageous stage presence, and with Queen's record sales exceeding 100 million, Freddie Mercury was a very private rock star. For the past 2 years, he'd lived like a virtual recluse. When he was seen, he was obviously frail, and given his admitted bisexuality, there'd been speculation about his health for many months. At the weekend, he said the time had come to tell the truth, but there was no hint of how far the disease had advanced. He died at his home in Kensington, West London, last night. Soon after the news was announced, one fan turned out and placed flowers outside the singer's door. With the flowers, a message.
I put down to Freddie, one of the greatest rock singers ever lived, from one of his loyal fans. And I put the flowers on the door.
In his statement at the weekend, Freddie Mercury said he hoped that everyone would join him, his doctors, and all those worldwide in the fight against this terrible disease.
Bronchopneumonia caused by AIDS. He was 45. And that's the news so far this morning. It's now 6 minutes past 8. Back to Lorraine.
And the later editions of The Sun report the death of rock star Freddie Mercury. The lead singer of the rock group Queen died late last night, just 2 days after confirming he was suffering from AIDS.
And the time now is coming up to 14 minutes past 8. A reminder, you're watching the BBC's Breakfast News. Here are this morning's headlines. A Catholic man has been shot dead in South Belfast. The murder came within hours of an explosion at the Crumlin Road jail in which a loyalist prisoner died. In Yugoslavia, the Croatian town of Osijek was shelled by artillery during the night despite the latest ceasefire. And the rock star Freddie Mercury has died 2 days after he confirmed that he had AIDS.
Freddie Mercury's flamboyant stage presence was the driving force behind one of Britain's most enduring rock bands. At Live Aid, he stole the show. In the 70s, Queen were at number one for 9 weeks with a song which broke new ground in pop video and in the use of opera. Freddie Mercury was openly bisexual. He enjoyed the rock star lifestyle to the full. He was born in Zanzibar of Persian descent and spent most of his childhood in India before going to art school in London. He was generous with his wealth and famous for his wild parties, though he played down the glamorous side.
You know, just like a housewife, to be honest. I just go on there, and do my job and then come home. Crazy little thing I love.
He gave a form which was pretty staid and sour, which was hard rock music, and it gave it a great personality, so much so now that, of course, there are a lot of flamboyant frontmen, but Freddie Mercury really is one of the most memorable performers in rock.
He'd known for 2 years he had AIDS, but continued with his music, the collapse in his health only glimpsed in rare photographs. Fans at his home in West London mourned the best-known British star to have died from the disease, but AIDS charities believe his greatest gift to his fans was to have openly admitted he was a sufferer.
Many of his fans would be at risk of HIV, just like he was. His behaviour did change, but not in time to prevent his own death. His hope, no doubt, was that through his openness, that many people throughout the world, some of the 100 million of his fans, would see that AIDS is a real illness. It's killing people every day. But together we can fight it.
Freddie Mercury will also be remembered for his often poignant songwriting.
the 6 o'clock news. From Anna Ford and from me, good evening.
This is BBC One. Now, as tributes flood in from all corners of the music world to the late Freddie Mercury, who died last night, we've a celebration of his life and career with a special introduction from Elton John.
Freddie Mercury was an incredible, innovative singer and frontman for a band. He was a very dear friend of mine, and it was a privilege to have known him for some of his life. He was very funny. He was extremely outrageous. He was very kind. And he was a great musician and one of the great frontmen of rock and roll bands. It's very hard to be a frontman. I mean, there's not many you can think of that have actually pulled it off. I mean, you can think of Jagger, you can think of Daltrey. And then you can think of Freddie Mercury. And Queen were one of the bands to come out of the 70s that was so innovative. I mean, when you look at videos today, Queen started videos off, really. They were the people that had all the ideas to begin with. Freddie always had a sense of humor, a sense of outrage. They stole the show at Live Aid. Quite simply, he was one of the most important figures in rock and roll over the last 20 years. I will miss him. We will all miss him, I think, for his music and his humanity. And the great thing is we still have his music to remember him by, and some wonderful footage to remember that Freddie Mercury was something special. Thank you.
The private service at West London Crematorium ended a short time ago. Mercury's coffin, with a single red rose on top, was borne into the crematorium from an old black Rolls Royce. His elderly parents were among the mourners for the 25-minute service, which was conducted according to his Zoroastrian faith. Priests in white robes chanted and prayed during the service. Hundreds of floral tributes from friends and fans were laid outside.
Sunday, a day after revealing he was suffering from AIDS. Fellow performers, including Elton John, Brian May and Anita Dobson, attended the service. Hundreds of wreaths were sent, including some from other pop stars. Queen is to re-release its best-known hit, Bohemian Rhapsody, next month, with the proceeds going to an AIDS charity.
In life, Freddie Mercury said he didn't have any real friends. At his funeral, they had to employ extra security to keep them away. Dozens of floral tributes had been arriving all morning, amongst them one from David Bowie. "We'll be missed," it said, echoing the sentiments of thousands of fans. In life, so flamboyant, in death, understated. His coffin borne into the chapel bearing a single red rose. Inside, a short service featuring the music of Montserrat Caballé was conducted according to Persian-born Freddie's Zoroastrian faith, the congregation joining with priests in prayer and chanting. The news of Freddie's death from AIDS on Sunday stunned the world, but none more so than the other members of Queen. There to mourn the loss of the man they called the greatest and most beloved member of our family. They were joined by Elton John and close friend Mary Austin, with Dave Clark, the man who witnessed Freddie, as he put it, going to sleep. And there, as always, the loyal fans paying their last respects.
He's rock and roll, he always has been. He always will be, even though he's now dead. Queen will never be again, but their music will live on. I don't care what anybody says.
"When I'm dead, who cares?" Freddie said in his last interview. Today, dozens proved they did. Fiona Phillips, Sky News.
Fellow performers, including Elton John, Brian May and Anita Dobson, attended the service. Hundreds of wreaths were sent, including some from other pop stars. Queen is to re-release its best-known hit, Bohemian Rhapsody, next month, with the proceeds going to an AIDS charity.
An old black Rolls-Royce brought Mercury's coffin to West London Crematorium.
It was carried in for the 25-minute service conducted according to Mercury's Zoroastrian faith by priests in white robes. Flowers sent from all over the world covered more than a quarter of an acre and were later distributed to AIDS wards in London.
Week saw the death of one of rock's biggest stars. On this day in 1975, the record Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen was at number one. It'll be re-released on Monday with the royalties going to the fight against AIDS. The bookmakers are certain it'll be the Christmas number one, and I have to agree with that. As our tribute to Freddie Mercury, we leave you with his best known hit. From all of us, a good night to you. Good night.
Good night.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy?
Magnificent performer, magnificent single, and a magnificent song sadly missed Freddie Mercury, who I think will be very pleased to know that he's almost certainly got the Christmas number one.
Hello again. Now, our pop video this morning is a tribute to Freddie Mercury, the lead singer of Queen, who died last week. Next week, members of the band are going to release two songs which they believe commemorate his memory best. Bohemian Rhapsody was the first pop video ever made, and of course it marked a turning point in the music industry. And Those Were the Best Days of Our Lives was Freddie's last video. Here they are.
Nothing really matters. Nothing really matters.
Golden memories. Later on in the programme, we'll be reflecting on Freddie Mercury's life and career with his friends from Queen, Brian May and Roger Taylor. Brian and Roger speaking publicly for the first time since Freddie's death last week. We'll take a break. Welcome back. Well, as you know, last week saw the death of one of the most flamboyant and popular figures in rock music, Freddie Mercury, lead singer with Queen. He led the group to international success, thrilled fans as well with his exciting stage performances. Joining us in the studio now to pay tribute and maybe to reflect on Freddie's memory for the first time are two of the band members, guitarist Brian May and drummer Roger Taylor. Thanks for coming in. We do appreciate you coming.
Thanks, mate.
If we can just ask a couple of questions first. How long did Freddie know that he was suffering from AIDS, full-blown AIDS?
I don't think that's a question we can answer because we don't actually know ourselves. It was always a very private thing with him. Mm. We knew for I guess we knew intuitively something was going on, but it wasn't talked about. He didn't officially tell us until just a few months before he went. Mm. But certainly he knew for 5 years or so or more, so he was living under the shadow for a very, very long time.
He was living under the shadow. And what did it do as far as you could see it and tell? Because in many ways he's a very private man, that's the irony of it, isn't it? But as far as you could see, what did it do to him, the knowledge that he was...
Well, the one thing he wanted to do was keep on working in the studio. He was absolutely determined to keep the group going and to keep working, and that actually kept him going.
See, we
for
watched
a long
earlier.
Time.
We watched earlier. Those are the days of our lives, and actually watching it was unbearably poignant just to watch it. So for you fellas to be in that, it must have been a difficult session emotionally.
Incredibly difficult.
Yes, it was hard. It was really, but we were sort of trying to support him through it, and I mean, he was incredibly brave at that time. Obviously, he knew, you know, and we all knew at that time. But you know, that the best thing is just to get on with life and to do it, and he did that, and I think he carried on very bravely, actually. Mm.
Now, one of the principal reasons you're here, and we're grateful you've come in. The commentators have all had their say, haven't they? Everybody's become instant experts on the life and past of Freddie Mercury, be they in the papers or be they on television, the commentators. Where did they go wrong and where did they go right in their assessments? You first.
Well, I mean, it's been quite distressing to read some of the reports in the press. One thing is that obviously nobody really knew him, but a lot of people sort of made out that they did. Also the fact that, I mean, he was a very private guy. But they got nearly all their facts wrong, and that they missed out the point of what he was actually like in private, which was actually a very shy, gentle, kind person. He wasn't the kind of persona that he put over on stage because, you know, he was an entertainer. And it makes his friends, I know the people who looked after him right to the end, I mean, they all get very angry when they see the way that he's represented in the English press, especially the tabloid press.
Yes, I mean, it would be wrong of us not to say that he has been depicted in certain quarters as a sort of decadent, wild, bisexual, irresponsible lover. Yeah. So how, what was actually the truth of that?
Yes, that definitely makes us very angry, because he was, certainly the Freddie we knew, wasn't wildly promiscuous, he wasn't consumed by drugs, any of these things that people are saying. He had a very responsible attitude to everyone that he was close to, and he was a very generous and caring person to all of the people that came through his life. And more than that, you can't ask, really. You know, as he moved from a relationship to another one, he was always very, as I say, aware of the effect he was having on people's lives.
Is it a peculiarity that maybe his private nature contributed to some of the lurid epitaphs? In other words, the reality was, big showman on stage, but immensely private off stage. Is that correct?
That's right. Nobody really got inside the shell. And so lots of the tabloids, I mean, it's just incredible. I read something in the Mirror last week, which was written by some poor old sick devil. Just so wrong. So they obviously made things up because they probably couldn't get inside. And for the last 18 months of his life, he was hounded by press outside his house. And we all have been up to a point. It's quite incredible in this country. But he really was a prisoner in his own house for the last 18 months of his life.
Were there times years ago, because I mean, you're familiar visitors here, both of you, when you'd liked him to have been more upfront and him to have answered interviews and maybe handled the press more? Would that have helped, do you think?
Not necessarily. I think we didn't always agree, and there were times when we talked about it, but Freddie was very much his own man. He made a decision very early on in his life that he was going to do things his way. And certainly we respected that. We all have our own ways, but within the group, you know, we respected that he was going to handle his own life. And certainly his own attitude to what he was suffering towards the end was his own business, you know. So in some senses, we were gagged by that, which was hard for us. You know, you find yourself even not being able to talk about it to friends. Now that's kind of lifted. We can be very, very open about how we feel.
It's interesting hearing you talking, because, Roger, you particularly give the impression that none of you really knew him. He wasn't one of those people you really knew.
I think, I mean, we were very close as a group. I mean, always, for 22 years, I think. But it's, even we didn't really know a lot of things about Freddie, because he was quite a mystery. But I tell you, we do feel absolutely bound to stick up for him, because he can't stick up for himself anymore. So, you know.
That's right. There's no curb on people being able to say things about people once they've died, is there? There's very little curb on what they can do when they're alive in this country. And I think one of the things, a lot of people said, what can we do for Freddie? And I think one of the things would be to try and get these laws changed and make sure that people don't have to put up with, you know, perhaps, you know, if we could ensure that there's some kind of lobby to bring in these protection of your private thoughts bill, you know, I forget what the proper word
is. It's interesting that state facts can be protected for periods of up to 25 to 50 years. And yet as soon as somebody is buried, it's an open season.
That's right. And there's no law to stop people disclosing parts of people's private lives when they're alive anyway. I mean, in France there is. You cannot publish details of somebody's private things without their consent.
You've come on because you're angry, basically, not because you wanted to get up early and appear on breakfast television. You've come on because you're angry, yeah? That's the main fuel,
yeah? Because we're angry. We also want to explain, really, what we feel that we can do now with sort of Freddie's legacy in a way, you know. And also, I think,
that's right, there's a lot to say, really, because Freddie made one crucial decision before he died, which was to announce the fact that he did have AIDS, which was a very brave and, I think, well-timed act on his part, because it gave us and those close to us a kind of weapon to talk about AIDS. You know, it would have been very easy for him to put on his death certificate pneumonia, you know, which he knew, and it could have perhaps sidestepped the whole thing. The fact that he announced it and said, look, I've got this, and there was no shame to that, I think is very important, because there shouldn't be from this point, or not from any point, any stigma to having this disease. It's nothing to do with, you know, somebody did something wrong and he's being punished. That's got to go. It has to go, you know. It's everybody's problem now.
We're going to talk much more later, fellas. I just love one theory about what created that magnificent showman. Was it the Persian background? Do you have any theories on...
It's so difficult because he was so much his own creation. He really was his own man in that sense. I really don't know. I mean,
it's like sporting or musical genius art. You wish you could distill it.
That's right,
Is it one-off?
Yes.
Listen, fellas, we'll be chatting much more later, but for the moment, thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks for having us.
He's a real showman.